The Lord be with you. All right, I only got through like five people because the world has been a shift in here today with so many folks in need. And I know that I didn't get over to this side of the building for prayer requests, so I'm going to take those from the floor in a moment. Good morning to those of you who are joining us for worship online. We are so glad you're here. I'm Pastor Jenny. We're at St. Paul's in New Cumberland, Pennsylvania. This is the 25th Sunday after Pentecost. Next weekend is the last of the whole church year. It's called Christ the King Sunday. And we'll be having three baptisms on Christ the King Sunday and celebrating and giving thanks to God for that incredible gift in our community. All right. These are some of the prayer requests that have been brought forward thus far. And one is, a few of us from this parish went to Zion Enola last Sunday for their final liturgy in their building. They are now Zion at large. Zion on the run, Zion on the find, whatever they are, I'm not sure. But their pastor, Gwen, is serving in Wartsville Road, so at St. Paul's there. In December, we're welcoming them here. I think I've told you that. Do you know this? Okay, good. So through the month of December, I'm going to encourage you, if you want to come to a later service, or you know somebody who has not been coming to church because they are like, it's way too early to get up for church, let them know that there'll be that second service and they can come for coffee hour first and then attend that service. Or if you're feeling like maybe I want to get to know them a little better, you can stick around, all right? So we're going to try to make them feel very welcome. I'm thinking it's 10:30 or 10:45. I'll find out specifically once she's decided. Thanks for asking. Thank you for asking. All right, so we'll be praying for Zion. I also want to update you on my friend Marty Pano. He has had his second transplant and is now still in the hospital recovering. So we're going to keep praying for Marty's well-being and that his body will not reject the second time through. I've cared for a couple of families. One is Bill Zerbe Sr. and the other is Colonel Stephen Boson, who was 101 and been through three wars. He was phenomenal. His family was incredible this week to get to know over at that beautiful Parthmore funeral home. And I just want to commend these two men to the Lord and thank God for their incredible lives. Linda, one of the reasons we didn't get too far was because we've got a few things happening over here. One is Linda has just been diagnosed with cancer, like recently. So when you're in coffee hour, shower her with your love, right? We're going to continue to love you and surround her with all of our prayers as the doctors determine what's going to happen and how to handle this mass that has been found. As I came back a little bit, I heard that we have some miners that are trapped in a tunnel. Do any of you know about this story in the news? I didn't get this one. All right, so we're going to be praying for folks that are stuck in a tunnel, as well as the Gaza situation, as that tries to unwind. Hopefully we'll get somewhere better on that. And then Dale was in the hospital this week, congestive heart failure. So they had to shock his heart, and he's going to be doing better. So we're just going to surround you, Rita, with you've already surrounded yourself with family, both of you ladies. You know what to do when the times get tough. Get somebody who loves you around you. So, and then the girl's dad was very anxious about what was going on with his dad and ended up in the hospital, too, with chest pains. So we're praying for both those men who are out of the hospital and doing better, but still needing prayer. And meanwhile, is it your granddaughter? So your granddaughter said, what is it with these men? They get to go to the hospital, I'm going too. And she had a baby. So we're celebrating baby Kelsey and Peter. So a little bit of bittersweet mixture going on there. And now you understand why it took me a while to get through this first corner. Are there other folks that you would like to include in our prayers? Yes, Jenny, I'm coming to you. Yes, we've got Gaza in there, and we will continue to pray for your family, Jenny. Anyone else you would like? Yes, I'm coming to you. So we need to find out what's happening with Kathy Rubel. Okay. Okay. It's been kind of a tough week for some of us, huh? Okay. Yes, ma'am. 1 second, Randy. I'll be right back to you. Heather Lynch. You want to say why or just say we're praying for Heather? Okay, so all that stuff after you've had surgery. Yeah. Oh, so she's waiting for surgery. That's kind of the worst. Let's hope that it heals itself on the way. That would be really good. Yes, Randy. Yes, please. And I know, Jean, do you want to say something about the candy also? So we'll have Randy first. Thank you, Randy. So new budgets have been produced and put out, so you can take a look at those. All right, Jean is coming up, I think, to talk about the candy, if he's got a minute.
We ordered the candy, 300 pounds of hard candy, wrapped of different kinds. Hopefully, it will be ready to be picked up on the 4th of December, which is the night that we'd like to pack it, so that we can get it out to the, I can never remember the outfit up in the morning that Tom's working with.
Oh, the New Hope Ministries.
New Hope Ministry.
Good
now, this is where we're taking the candy this year. We talked to the lady up there, and she said she'd be mighty, mighty proud and very happy to do it. So, if you can, round 6 o'clock, be down in the Friendship Hall. Doesn't take long. And we'll back it up and get it out there. Thank you.
Thank you. And I'm reminded that when we were at dinner this week, that Tom was talking about how he went and helped with distribution of turkeys.
Yeah. Tom, since he retired, has not only taken over 3/4 of my duties, but he also works up there in Lamont, part-time.
Yeah, he does, helping out at the New Hope Ministries. Oh, speaking of Tom,
yes.
Not the devil.
Okay.
Would you like to share another announcement?
Yes, Thursday night council voted for Pastor Nicole Pastor Thursday night. And we also have going on her package for her day and dungeon.
Ah, thanks, Tom. The 10th, yep. You're right. All I usually say from my generation is be there or be square. Thank you, Tom. I appreciate that announcement. Are there other things that the community should be aware of or any other prayer requests? I didn't take a look back there, ladies. Do you have prayer requests? Okay. We're good? All right. I'm sorry? We're all good. All right. If that's everything, then why don't we begin our worship then? And how we do that is we stand together, call upon God's name, and make the sign of the cross upon ourselves. Blessed be the Holy Trinity. One God in whose image we are made, who claims us and calls us beloved. Amen. We'll take a moment for reflection. You can stand or kneel or be seated as you're comfortable.
Holy One, we confess that we are not awake for you. We are not faithful in using your gifts. We forget the least of our siblings. We do not see your beautiful image in one another. We are infected by sin that divides your beloved community. Open our hearts to your coming. Open our eyes to see you in our neighbor. Open our hands to serve your creation. Amen. Beloved, we are God's children, and Jesus, our beloved, opens the door to us. Through Jesus, you are forgiven. By Jesus, you are welcome. In Jesus, you are called to rejoice. Let us live in the promises prepared for us from the foundation of the world. Amen. As we prepare to sing the hymn, I just want to give you forewarning that the readings are pretty tough today, so just kind of prepare yourself for them, okay? We're going to sing, "Mine Eyes Have Seen the Glory." Righteous God, our merciful Master, you own the earth and all its peoples, and you give us all that we have. Inspire us to serve you with justice and wisdom, and prepare us for the joy of the day of your coming. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated for the hearing of the word.
The first reading is from Zephaniah. Be silent before the Lord God, for the day of the Lord is at hand. The Lord has prepared a sacrifice. He has consecrated his guests. At that time, I will search Jerusalem with lamps, and I will punish the people who rest complacently on their dregs. Those who say in their hearts, the Lord will not do good, nor will he do harm. Their wealth shall be plundered, and their houses laid waste. Though they build houses, they shall not inhabit them. Though they plant vineyards, they shall not drink wine from them. The great day of the Lord is near, near and hastening fast. The sound of the day of the Lord is bitter. The warrior cries aloud there. That day will be a day of wrath, a day of distress and anguish, a day of ruin and devastation, a day of darkness and gloom. A day of clouds and thick darkness, and a day of trumpet blast and battle cry against the fortified cities and against the lofty battlements. I will bring such distress upon people that they shall walk like the blind. Because they have sinned against the Lord, their blood shall be poured out like dust and their flesh like dung. Neither their silver nor their gold will be able to save them on the day of the Lord's wrath. In the fire of his passion, the whole earth shall be consumed for a full, a terrible end. He will make of all the inhabitants of the earth. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
The second reading is from 1 Thessalonians. Now, concerning the times and the seasons, brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anything written to you, for you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. When they say, there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them, as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and there will be no escape. But you, beloved, are not in darkness, for that day to surprise you like a thief. For you are all children of light and children of the day. We are not of the night or of darkness. So then let us not fall asleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who are drunk get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober and put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has destined us not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other, as indeed you are doing. The word of the Lord.
Before I read the gospel, I need to say that the number talent, the word talent means a large sum, like multiple years, like decades of employment. So I'm going to change it with numbers that would actually be meaningful to us today. So you'll see what's written, but you'll hear meaningful numbers today. The Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 25th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to the disciples, "For it's as if a man going on a journey summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave $5 million, to another $2 million, to another one, and to another one, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received $5 million went off at once and traded with them and made $5 million more. In the same way, the one who had $2 million made $2 million more. But the one who had received $1 million went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. The one who had received the $5 million came forward bringing $5 million more, saying, 'Master, you handed me $5 million. See, I've made $5 million more.' His master said to him, 'Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You've been trustworthy in a few things. I'll put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master.' And the one with $2 million also came forward saying, 'Master, you handed me $2 million. See, I've made you $2 million more.' His master said to him, 'Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You've been trustworthy in a few things. I'll put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master.' Then the one who had received only $1 million also came forward saying, 'Master, I knew that you're a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your $1 million in the ground. Here, you have what is yours.' But the master replied, 'You wicked and lazy slave, you knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I didn't scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers. And on my return, I would have received what was my own with interest. So take that $1 million from him. Give it to the one with $10 million. For to all those who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness where there'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth. The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Hey, Jesus. You got a good sense of humor. Okay, this one is for the older set in our crowd. See if you know where this is from. Thanks for the memories. Oh, you know who it is immediately. Bob Hope, yeah. Yesterday, Tom and Elizabeth and I were in the car. And, you know, Tom likes to listen to a certain set of music. It's not my favorite, but when I get in the car, I'm usually like, can you turn that trash off? And he'll say, okay, and switch it over to, like, something a little more family-friendly, I put it. But this time he decided to put on the radio station that has all the oldies, all the old radio stories. And, of course, on came Bob Hope's show. And he always ended his radio show with that song, Thanks for the Memories. This brought back a flood of memories for me. Back in the day, Bob Hope was a comedian famous in the 40s and 50s and beyond. He spent his life as part of the United Services Organization, otherwise known to me only ever as the USO. I didn't know what that was till I looked it up. And he would share stories of humor with soldiers who were away from their homes and away from their families. It was difficult times for soldiers because they just never knew if they'd see their families again. I was lucky enough to be in one of his audiences as a little girl. I told Tom the only joke I remember him saying was, what do you get when you mix an Arab and a Mexican together? Oil of Olay. That's the only joke I remember from the whole thing as a little kid, because I thought that was hysterical. At the end of his shows, he'd wrap it up with this bittersweet song, in which he would adjust the verses each time he would end the show with whatever had happened in that show. And you could leave with a tear in your eyes from laughter, but also it was kind of mingled with the truth that no one really knows what's going to happen tomorrow with these soldiers and their families. So we can just say, thanks for the memories today. Now, Jesus was not a comedian in the same way that Bob Hope was, but he had a similar way of telling stories with 5 billion talents, right? And this horrible guy is the master. So he's trying to bring home a point with this story. This one is following right after the one from last week. We're nearing the end of the gospel. We're at the 25th chapter, like I said to you last week in Matthew. And Jesus is winding up his teaching with a series of whoppers, things to make you sit there and go, what is he trying to say? Last week, we heard him tell folks that the kingdom of heaven is like a huge party. If you don't fill up with the oil now and come to the party, you're not allowed in. We don't want you stinking party poopers coming in here and saying, I don't have enough. We want people here that are excited about life. Those who are invited are asked to be wise and prepared for the party. Don't be foolish and unprepared to celebrate. Come filled with joy and ready to party. Today the story continues. Jesus shares a story about a harsh master who delights in those who took his fortune and used it to build him an even greater fortune. What would you do with 5 million? I mean, it was way more than 5 million because you had 5 plus 2 plus 1. It's a lot of millions to have, okay? Then he turns to the one who buried it in the ground and says, you're just worthless. He takes that pile of money and gives it to the worker who uses it to build even more of a fortune for him. And then he tells somebody, just take that guy and throw him out in the outer darkness where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. Well, yeah, you know, if you lost 1 million and you knew your boss was ticked off at you, you'd be weeping and gnashing your teeth. I really doubt that Jesus is claiming to be this harsh master. Nor is this a good description of our God. God is not a harsh master, and Jesus does not want a pile of money. What did he tell to all the wealthy people? Give it away. Take care of the poor. This isn't Jesus trying to amass more money. And that whole thing about a bank In Jewish culture, in Jesus's theological world, you're not allowed to make money in a bank on your stuff. You're not allowed to lend money and make money on it. So that would have been against Jesus' lifestyle anyway. So what is Jesus saying here with this text? While there are many, many, many interpretations of this story, I'm leaning into what I'm going to call the Bob Hope interpretation. Okay? It's my own, so in case you wanted to guess. Okay. It's a thanks for the memories moment. Jesus is wrapping up his story. He has taught his friends many things. And his friends are sitting there with him at the Mount of Olives, and he's riffing on his themes that he's been teaching all the way through, the lessons that he's shared regularly with them over these years that they've been walking together. In this case, Jesus is telling them again that if you think that a parent would give good things to a child, how much more would your heavenly Father give? That was at the old beginning of Matthew, right? Like, why would a good parent give a scorpion if there's a loaf of bread available? Like, that's just not the way a good parent is. So here he is saying once again, if you think a harsh master would give $5 million, a massive treasure, to his servants, how much more will God give you? That's a harsh master. How much more will God, who is good, give you? Something more valuable? Maybe the whole world? Is that what God has given us? God gives us everything, and we're left to care for that abundance. We're expected to be wise with this gift, but also not to be so afraid of the maker of this world that we would rather bury our talents in fear and not risk anything because we might fail. God calls us to a life that involves caring for this world, for the ones God loves in this world. We can lavishly spend our lives on those folks, right? I can lavishly give everything away, because God's going to take what I've given away in my life. And I said this at the council meeting this week. You can't outgive God. We have in perpetuity, I guess, given about $500 to three little organizations. And we were like, should we be giving this just because we've always been giving this? And we're like worried about money, and should we? And then all of a sudden, one of the groups down in the basement that has not given anything for years turned in a check for $500. And I was like, duh, what are we thinking here? You know, you cannot outgive God. Don't bury your treasure in fear. Use lavishly what you have. Because Jesus used his own life to show what lavish love looks like. He spent his life over those years with his people, with us, showing us what life is all about. At the end, we can also sing with Bob Hope, thanks for the memories, God. Our songs will be mixed with memories that are tinged with sadness and also gratitude. Jesus taught his friends not to be afraid. Don't go back to fishing for fish, guys. Live this life the way I showed you. The harsh master would throw you away for your failures, but I'm going to do something that will turn all of that around. I will lay down my life so that you can be set free to live. And soon they will be sitting in that upper room where Jesus will do something. What does Jesus first do when they walk in the room? Do you remember what he does? He washes their feet. And then they sing hymns, and probably the favorite part, they drink wine. They tell stories. And then he's going to institute what we use in the scriptures, or in the liturgy, we say, and he institutes a new covenant, which is an old word. It just means I got a new agreement with you. Me and God, we got this new agreement with you. I'm going to tell you what it means. My very body and blood is in this game with you. Okay? I got skin in the game. It's not just you who die. Me too. Even more, he promises them at that meal that they are not to be afraid, for he goes ahead of them to prepare a place for them with chocolate, and when they die, he will bring them to where he is. And his promise continues down through the ages to us, right? That promise is for real all the way through to us. One of Bob's most famous one-liners was, "A bank is a place that will lend you money if you prove that you don't need it." I think Jesus would say, heaven is a place that will give you a place because he already paid admission for all of us. This week in our country, we're going to celebrate a holiday, Thanksgiving. Let's think about adding to our meal this week a version of thanks for the memories to the meal. What have you learned from your life with Jesus? What gifts do you bring to that table on Thursday? Maybe it's your macaroni and cheese. I don't know. But it's probably a lot more than that at the table. Maybe it's thanks for a little baby. Maybe it's thanks for incredible doctors that are good. Are you willing to be unafraid and risk it all for Jesus? Let us pray. God, we hear the harsh master stuff and we start thinking, oh no, there's hell and God's going to send us there because we're not good and we failed. And we start getting so worried by these stories rather than paying attention to what you're trying to tell us. If someone that harsh could be that generous with people at the top, how much more is a God who lavishly gives us everything, including the whole wide world, not just 5 million, but everything? We thank you, Lord, for the incredible gifts of our families and our relationships. Yeah, there's struggles along the way, Lord, and there's tests and there's fear. And we wonder, Lord, why suffering? But you tell us, look, I'm with you through it all. I love you. And when the time comes to come home, I got you because you're mine. So don't be afraid. Use your life now. Use your life now to tell everyone about God's love, about God's mercy, about God's abundance. We thank you for sending Jesus. We thank you, Jesus, for these lessons, for teaching us that we are precious in your sight, with humor and with reality. Thank you for the memories, Lord, in this place and beyond. Amen. We have a hymn to sing. It is Lord of Light. Let us stand together as we share in singing.
Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us turn our hearts to God, our breath and life, as we pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Gracious God, you give talents and gifts to all your people, and you equip the church to serve. Turn us from fear and self-serving ways, that we use our talents to glorify you and encourage our neighbor. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. You have been our dwelling place from one generation to another. Sustain the life of the planet. Protect farmlands and harvests. Direct all people in wise stewardship of all the earth's resources. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. You call us to honesty and integrity. Instill these values in the hearts of all nations and their leaders. God, we pray for our country leaders. Free any who are oppressed. Expose all corruption. And bring redemption to victims of injustice. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. You teach us to count our days that we may gain a wise heart. Where there is sickness or sorrow, bring healing. Where there is loneliness, reveal your love and community. We remember within our community today, especially Peggy Warmkessel, Anita and Joanne Painter, Hannah, Trudy Stumm, Loie Parker, Steve Knock, Judy Hunt, Edsel, Debbie Aldrich, the Holden family, Anna, Kathy Miller, Marty and his wife, Jenny's mom and her sister, Marty and Paul Sheffer, Ken, Judy Smith and her family, Bob and Maggie Fogelman, Sonia, Marie, Pam Murray, Shauna, Ken Lytle, Dave and Holly Kutz, John Van Brakel. We also remember Linda. We pray that you would give her your strength this day. We pray for the miners who are trapped in a tunnel. We pray for all who are in Gaza and all the families waiting for their loved ones to return home. We pray for Dale, as his heart is going through so much right now. And for Andrew, we pray and give you thanks, Lord God, for little baby Kelsey. We pray for Jenny's family and for Kathy Rubel. We give you thanks, Lord God, for Heather, and we pray for her body that it may heal before the surgery is even needed. We also take a moment to name those in our hearts that are heavy there, Lord. We pray for them now. Be their rest and comfort. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. We pray for the faith formation ministries of our church. Give to all our children and youth and adults who study your word the breastplate of faith and love. Shape us by your love and show us how to encourage one another. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Gracious God, you are faithful in all generations. For the promise of life and rest and for the witness of those who've died in faith, especially William Zerbe Sr. and Colonel Stephen Boson, and those whom we miss, we praise you for your goodness. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great.
We offer our spoken prayers and those held in our hearts, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. Let's share that peace with one another. Peace be with you, those who are here online for worship. I saw who was on there. It's good to see you all. And please share that peace with one another as we send our peace out to you. Peace be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread. And when he'd given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to boldly pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. There is a place for you at the banquet. Come and feast at Jesus' table. Of Christ given for you.
Please stand for the blessing. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Lord Jesus, in this simple meal you have set a banquet. Sustain us on the journey. Strengthen us to care for the least of your beloved children. And give us glad and generous hearts as we meet you on the way. Amen.
May the God of all creation, in whose image we are made, who claims us and calls us beloved, who strengthens us for the service, give you reason to rejoice and be glad. The blessing of God, sovereign, Savior, and Spirit, be with you today and always. Amen.